one.
Right, okay, no, we're not doing this again. Like, I get why this exists. It's almost too obvious to point out. Knife Talk was the most popular song on Certified Lover Boy. Jimmy Coast was the most popular song from Honestly Nevermind. Drake in 21 is a proven winning formula, and Drake likes winning. And it's a good deal for 21, too. He gets to write off Drake's preordained success for free hits. Even if he only shows up on about a third of this supposed collab album, who cares? His name is there, his sound is there, boom, done. But there's a desperation to this release. Drake's dance album was rejected en masse. The kids only want to see him put out more of the same. But do they? Most of them would rather go back to the other songs they already know and love. They want to listen to Wants and Needs, they want to listen to In My Feelings, they want to listen to Passion Fruit, etc. They'll still check out the new songs, but because they don't bring anything new to the table, they'll get bored and move on in a few weeks. And the problem there is, Drake loves attention. It's all he cares about now. He needs those eyes back on him as often as possible. He puts out at least one or two projects pretty much every year, and his big album drops have been excessively bloated since Views back in 2016. It's all just to make himself the center of the conversation again, overwhelm the discourse by sheer force. But Drake is, inherently, a very boring person. He doesn't do interesting things, he doesn't have interesting thoughts, the only things he has to his name are being rich, being corny, and being misogynistic. So the only way he can get anything to stick is by saying more and more outlandish things, being more toxic, being more embarrassing, glamorizing his persona more and more to cartoonish proportions. The end goal is that something he says will get him attention, whether it's being dunked on, sparking outrage, whatever, because then people are looking at him, and his swarms of defenders will show up to have his back no matter what he says. He gets to be the main character of pop music again, and his reward is a big fat payday. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that Drake has become the Alex Jones of rap. Hope that turns out well for him. Alright, angry part of the video out of the way, the rest of the songs this month are all at least pretty solid, so let's just get right into the thick of it.
Lift me up.
You know what? I was starting to think she'd never be back. Glad to be proven wrong. And let's get this out of the way. Yes, I'm underwhelmed. That seems to be the broad reaction to this song. Like, that's it? I mean, okay, it's not bad, it's actually pretty good, but that's Rihanna at her bass level. The real issue here is the song isn't much of anything. Like, it certainly doesn't give Rihanna any room to show personality. It's a movie soundtrack cut, so of course it doesn't. But wait, no, that's not fair. Vegas gave Doja Cat plenty of room to be Doja Cat. Maybe with a limiter on, sure, but if that song had been given to someone else, it would have turned out completely different. Give Lift Me Up to, I don't know, Beyonce? And it probably wouldn't have changed much at all.
Drowning in an endless sea.
And it was written as a tribute to the late Chadwick Boseman, which is nice, but like, the writing is so vague and broadly sketched that it'd be impossible to tell that without context. Hell, it'd be impossible to tell it was supposed to be a tribute song, period. Nothing here screams death or loss, it's just a song about needing love. How do you get outdone on that aspect by Charlie Friggin' Poof and Wiz Friggin' Khalifa? Jesus. It's still a very pretty song. It's got a high floor, courtesy of Rihanna being the one performing it, but it's also got a frustratingly low ceiling, barely enough room to squeeze in between the two. And for her first real proper hit in over 5 years, it was pretty much destined to disappoint. I don't know why we keep getting a new SZA song right at the tail end of these last few years, but I ain't complaining since I always liked being a new SZA song. I just wish we got them more often. And yeah, this is nice. The percussive clatter creates a really synchronized groove that's kinda cool, and SZA herself remains one of the most compelling performers in the mainstream. Content-wise, it's kind of in a similar place as her last two hits, though they sort of trace an arc in reverse. Good Days is brushing off your stresses to look forward to a better future. I Hate You is the breaking point where she cusses out her ex for making her feel bad about herself. And Sure It Is, well, what led up to that? Wrestling with the anxieties this guy makes her feel and how it complicates her feelings towards him. Where she thinks she's the problem, not him.
Ain't it dark right now? Feeling lost, but I like it.
And I can't really relate to that as easily, but it's something I can empathize with at the very least. Sure, it also lacks the lushness of her last two hits, so yeah, I can't say I like it quite as much as either, but... Well, I expect it to grow on me anyways. There's just something about SZA songs. They're very easy to return to. Maybe because they're just chill, even in their bitterness. Normally, songs that never really progress or change over the runtime frustrate me, but it just works when SZA does it. Probably because she can carry a song on her own just fine. It's the kind of low-key vibe music I can enjoy the way it's intended to be enjoyed. I dig it. Right, time to talk about Midnights again. Again. Let's see, how about all the songs that stayed in the top 10 for a second week? That'd be Lavender Haze, Bejeweled, and... Ooh, okay, well, I'm gonna save that one for later, hint hint. Anyways, yeah, let's make this quick. I mean, this one's pretty straightforward and blunt. A shot against all the people who just see Taylor, who see all women as an outdated gender role rather than an actual person. The perfect little 1950s housewife. The object of affection, emphasis on object. The trophy. And that's not what love is. That's not how Taylor and her lover feel about each other. They're in it for the feelings they share, not any expectations others have placed upon them. And there's also an aspect of how weirdly intrusive people are towards celebrities' personal lives. Not just the paparazzi, but popular culture at large. We don't really need to know what anyone's doing in private, right? You'd hate it if someone invaded on your privacy too. All we should expect to know about a celebrity is what they choose to put out publicly, no less and no more. This isn't exactly one of my favorites from the album. The writing is sharp, but it's not directed at me, and I can merely nod my head in agreement with it. And the tune itself is fine, kinda catchy, but the airy, empty, washed out production doesn't quite do it for me on this one. Still good for sure, but I have to assume the main reason it's sticking around is because it's, you know, the opener. And the reason this next one stuck around is because, well... Best believe I'm still bejeweled. When I walk in the room, I can still make the whole place shimmer. Yeah, it got the second video, and I get why. It's one of the most pop-ready songs on the album, between the big sticky hook, the shiny sparkling production, and the, well, fairly uncomplicated content. You don't respect me, but I'm still hot as hell, so whatever, I'm gonna go have a good time without you. Which is a nice little girl power message too, so hell yeah, sis. Baby love, I think I've been a little too... I will say it feels a bit shallow, like there's enough here to justify its place on Midnight's, but you could pretty easily simplify its message to just I'm awesome and not really be missing that much. It's also a bit overwritten and clumsy in spots too, in a kind of distracting way, but the tune on this one's pretty good, so I'd still rather be on the side of defending it. And the brief comment on the third one. If you know, you know, but despite not having a video, despite not being towards the start of the album, it's ended up as the third most popular song on the album anyways, the one the fans chose. And I'm glad as hell they did. Let's hope it gets pushed as a single next. You already dropped the ball of Cruel Summer, Taylor. We can't. I can't go through that again. Please. Have y'all seen The Weeknd's Twitter feed recently? It's so good, it's so funny. He's just passively aggressively memeing on how neither of his two most popular albums right now are Dawn FM. You know, the album we released this year? It's hilarious and so in character for 2022. That the only big hit he got this year is from freaking 2016. I mean, this song's been going viral all year. I almost feel awkward talking about it now that the year's drawing to a close. Screw whatever the year is gonna tell you, this is one of the biggest hits of 2022. And this is exactly the kind of song you expect to go viral on TikTok. Huge, instantly memorable hook with a very straightforward I would die for you sentiment, and the rest of the song is... I'm finding ways to manipulate the feeling you're going through. Kinda mid. Weird, lumpy production that sounds kinda empty. The Weeknd crooning in his upper register that feels weirdly thin. It's basically filling space between the choruses. Like, okay, I do like the build-ups of the chorus, but that's about it. It's not unpleasant, and it being okay at best just lets the hook hit all the harder. But this is a song you come to for one part and one part only. Again, perfect for TikTok. The lyrical arc is fairly typical for this era of The Weeknd, where he knows they're both bad for each other, and they should break up, but he simply can't because he loves her too much. So much that he'd, well, die for her. And I firmly believe The Weeknd, the character, would die for her, but, I mean, again, this is nothing special. Like, this did grow on me after a few listens, but I still can't help but feel a little underwhelmed by it. Now make less than zero, single, dammit. And that's all we have for this month, and in fact, this chart year on Billboard Monthly. Next up on the docket is the top 10 best hit songs of 2022, and oh boy is it gonna be a good one. Stay tuned for that near the start of December, you won't want to miss it. Until next time, have yourselves a merry little Christmas, and don't forget to turn on your anti-Mariah force fields.
Or else.